reason for aortic stenosis in etiology aspects. First of all, that is congenital aortic valve with calcification, which is 2% of the population and maybe have autosomal dominant inheritance with incomplete penetrance. Rheumatic heart disease on second place, but very, very rare in nowadays, and tricuspid aortic valve disease with calcification or degenerative aortic stenosis, which is known also as new or sclerocalcific aortic stenosis, and now is the most common cause of aortic stenosis in adults. And its frequency is increased with increasing the ages of the population, with improvement in diagnostic modalities and especially primary Doppler echocardiography. And the symptoms and the prognosis are related with degree of left ventricle outflow tract obstruction. And other forms of obstruction also must make indifferential diagnosis. In first of all, it is supravalvular aortic stenosis, discrete congenital subvalvular aortic stenosis, and hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, where the gradient may be dynamic and may be not seen on the first examination, but during stress test may be increased interventricular gradient more than 30 millimeters and increased even to 100 millimeters and giving syncopal symptomatic. And the pathophysiology is in connection with progressive valvular narrowing and obstruction to left ventricle outflow, which giving, of course, in pressure overward, compensatory concentric hypertrophy to increase listen the increased wall stress. So maybe have an diastolic dysfunction and decreased ventricle compliance. Ischemia may be due from increased myocardial oxygen consumption from hypertrophy of the increased left ventricular mass, and also when valve obstruction become critical, may be happening left ventricular systolic failure. In some patients, it's not a good, adequate concentric hypertrophy, and there the left ventricle react with early left ventricle dysfunction. So the pathophysiology is due of left ventricle outflow obstruction, which increase the left ventricle systolic pressure with compensatory hypertrophy and myocardial ischemia and left ventricle dysfunction and left ventricle failure. The long latent asymptomatic period, but three cardinal symptoms of aortic stenosis. First of all is angina, and maybe difficult sometimes to think about acute coronary syndromes. Is due to myocardial ischemia from oxygen supply demand mismatch, but maybe also have combination and in older people aortic stenosis with three vessel disease or coronary syndromes. And this angina is due of increased oxygen demand. secondary may be due to compression of the vessels. And when begin this symptom, average survival is 5 years. The other big syncope is the syncope, which maybe have many phases due to arrhythmia, due to abnormal vasodepressor reflexes, and of the obstruction of left ventricle outflow, which giving hypotonia, and due to reduced cerebral perfusion, maybe orthostatic, maybe during physical activity, and medication related. So must be very careful to giving nitrates to these patients according their angina symptomatic or due to arrhythmia. Every hypertrophy is risk for sudden death for ventricular tachycardia, and also with progression of the dysfunction of atrial fibrillation. The heart failure is the other symptom, and it may be manifest as orthopnea, dyspnea, or pulmonary edema. And as you see, if happening heart failure, the average survival, if the patient is not operated, it 1 to 2 years. So it's very important to these patients to be operated on time, because as happening left ventricle dysfunction, the prognosis is not good. Sudden cardiac death may be occur as initial presentation in asymptomatic patients with severe aortic stenosis, and must looking these patients very carefully to have echocardiography control on 3 to 6 months to control how rise the gradient of aortic valve. The typical of the physical exam is the small pulse, pulsus parvus and tardus, also narrow pulse pressure between systolic and diastolic pressure, and also maybe have sustained apical impulse from the concentric hypertrophy, even systolic trio. But the best sign is the systolic ejection murmur, which is heard through precordium, but best heard on the aortic area in full expiration, and usually radiate to carotid. So must auscultate the patient and on the neck, and the murmur intensity peaks is later in systole as progress aortic stenosis with typical diamond shape systolic murmur, then grade 3 from 6 scale for the murmurs also have systolic trio. Do you remember what is systolic trio? And it's usually typically loudest in the second right intercostal space with radiation to carotid. Maybe a first sound, normal or soft. Second sound may be normal in mild aortic stenosis, but as the aortic stenosis worsens, second sound is delayed by prolonged systolic ejection time and maybe paradoxically speak. Also, maybe have the patient late peaking systolic murmur. On the ACG, maybe have typical signs with all criteria for left ventricle hypertrophy, not only the voltage of air waves, but also negative T waves. X-ray maybe show calcification on the aortic root and knot and poststenotic dilatation in the ascending aorta. The transthoracal echocardiography is diagnostic test of choice, because give us the gradient as using color Doppler, maybe giving concomitant aortic or mitral regurgitation, maybe evaluate the degree of left ventricle hypertrophy. The normal thickness of the septum is around 10-11, and in aortic stenosis may be given the rise to 14-15 millimeters, but is symmetric, not as in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Also giving information and allow us for calculation of the valve area by planimetry, also as in mitral stenosis. Here is the X-ray, as you see here, some calcification of the aortic root and post-stenotic dilatation. Here is not dilatation of the left ventricle, but as in hypertension, so configuration. And here is the systolic gradient between aortic valve and left ventricle. As you see here and here, the calcium on the valvular leaf, that's of the aortic valve. And as you see, this is one big aortic gradient. And how will help the catheterization in this patient? Of course, is the patient have coronary artery disease prior to assessment for aortic valve surgery, and also to have concomitant aortic regurgitation or mitral regurgitation and left ventricle dysfunction. Other tests which are important is exercise ACG testing in asymptomatic patients of aortic stenosis to assess their functional functional class, and patients with positive tests may be taken up to valve replacement because maybe have drop in blood pressure during the test due to vasodilatation, and maybe have symptomatic. And also dobutamine stress test, this is echo, in combination with infusion, slowly giving infusion of dobutamine, which increase the contraction, improve. And so we have talked in the patient with low ejection fraction who have left ventricle systolic dysfunction, maybe have low gradient, but as making dobutamine stress test improve contraction and the gradient increase. And so in this patient say that they have low gradient, but in a low ejection fraction, and real their gradient and their aortic stenosis is more heavy and have indication for operation. What is the according severity, the classification of the aortic stenosis under 25 millimeter gradient is mild, 20 to 40 moderate, and over 40 gradient is millimeter is severe aortic stenosis. So as you see, and according aortic valve area, under 1 foot centimeter is severe aortic stenosis. And the normal valve area is between 3 to 4 quarter centimeter. In mild is from 1.5 to 3, and in severe is under 1. But the peak gradient in the heavy aortic stenosis is usually more than 40. The previous was 60 millimeter. And the prognosis is progresses and with gradually worsens over time if the stenosis is severe and the symptoms begin. The prognosis, if the patient not operated, is not good. Life expectancy is 5 years when have symptoms of angina, or we think of will die in 3 years, and heart failure to within 2 years. What is the management? In asymptomatic phase, avoid strenuous activity to prevent symptoms, to prevent symptomatic medical therapy is with not effect, and from treatment is surgery. Medical therapy will be with vasodilators if the patients have hypertension also, but must be careful to avoid hypovolemia and hypotonia. Also, with caution to use nitrates and diuretics. And the algorithm is from one side, in connection with their functional class, or for, with other side, with their a gradient according to Doppler echocardiography, of course, obligatory catheterization, pre-operation to see if the patient have coronary artery disease. And first treatment in was of course balloon aortic valvuloplasty, but in the older patients with calcinosis it is impossible. The main treatment is aortic valve replacement for symptomatic patients, and nowadays that operation is with very good operative results. For this operation are indicated all symptomatic patients, or also asymptomatic patients with severe aortic stenosis and either decrease left ventricle ejection fraction, who are appreciated for operation aortic and their coronary disease. So the indications are symptomatic patient, may be possible some methods, and you may be here in the last years the TAVI operation or transcatheter aortic valve replacement during during catheterization, and a big good results received in the patients, especially which are with comorbidities, which who are risk for open operation, and the number of the TAVI operation increased very, very because the patient's age increased, and this is very often valve disease in the older patient. And aortic valve replacement may be indication not only in symptomatic patients, in patients with severe optic stenosis who are undergoing CABG operation, or in patients with severe optic stenosis and left ventricle ejection fraction. Also patients who have abnormal response to exercise, such development of symptoms of hypotonia during exercise stress test, maybe delayed in the patients who are asymptomatic, but they must be looking carefully, very closely, and every 3 to 6 months, when have progression of the aortic jet velocity more than 5 milliseconds, then these patients must be sent to operation, must thinking about the prevention of sudden cardiac death. Transcatheter techniques may be balloon aortic valve, valvoplasty, which is a non-surgical alternative for aortic stenosis, and especially in congenital aortic stenosis in pediatric population, of course, because in these patients have no calcium, and they have no risk of disruption of the leaflets and the acute complication. Also transcatheter TAVI with high surgical risk or contraindication. As you see here, how is looking the AV prosthesis during the catheter, and of course these patients must have good estimation of their order of the size with computer. Must exclude it coronary artery disease, and after that must be several months on anticoagulation. The other valve disease is aortic regurgitation, which may be acute and chronic. And in etiology aspect, primary valve disease, first of all, rheumatic, more than two-thirds of the patients, for acute, maybe infective endocarditis, of course, trauma, because PEET valve giving not only aortic stenosis, it giving and aortic regurgitation. The sinew degeneration maybe give and aortic regurgitation. But here the reason for the aortic regurgitation are not only on the level of the valve, it may be and on the aortic root, and degenerative with giving dilatation of the orthodegenerative heart disease, some forms of syphilis, especially Marfan syndrome, ankylosing spondylitis, aortic aneurysm with dissection, and for a reason for acute aortic regurgitation, systemic hypertension, giant cell arteritis, and annual aortic ectasia. For the acute aortic regurgitation, as in mitral regurgitation, the hemodynamic is different because you have no time for compensatory mechanism to include it, and the heart rep with high pressure of the filling, in the chronic with compensatory hypertrophy and dilatation of the left ventricle. So the reason of acute aortic regurgitation is infective endocarditis, dissection of the aortic, some collagen vascular disease, especially my fun, as you know, giving desiccation of the aorta in young people, in pregnant women, some connective tissue disease, large and medium vessel arteritis, trauma maybe giving of the aorta as in car accident, and also the distance of the prosthetic valve. The pathophysiology is due to a more stroke volume regurgitate into left ventricle during diastole, which giving left ventricle volume over wall, and cardiac output is maintained by increasing stroke volume. That's why, and the blood pressure, as you remember, is with very low diastole and maybe with a high systolic volume of at the expense of the increased left ventricle and diastolic volume. But sometimes it's happening left ventricle dilatation and early left ventricle failure. That is in a chronic aortic regurgitation because incomplete closure of the aortic valve giving backflow of blood to left ventricle and now receive blood to normal away and the other receive regurgitation volume during diastole, which giving overwork of the left ventricle, and the left ventricle react with hypertrophy with dilatation, and in late stage left-sided heart failure with low cardiac output. In first, of course, have left atrial pressure, so maybe have left atrium hypertrophy and arrhythmia at the atrial fibrillation with pulmonary pressure and congestion and total heart failure. So the clinical history have a long latent period. Patients maybe have no symptoms, no complaints, but when begin cardiomegaly, when begin left ventricle dysfunction, so begin the complaints with dyspnea. Syncope is rare here. Also have no symptoms. Symptoms so of hypoperfusion, but in the acute severe aortic regurgitation, left ventricle decompensation occur with fatigue, severe dyspnea, and hypotonia. In chronic severe aortic regurgitation, all the symptoms become gradually, and the patient is long-term period asymptomatic, and the compliance begins after cardiomegaly and left ventricle dysfunction. So the symptoms are the symptoms of heart failure, maybe of angina, chest pain in aortic dissection, favor in infective endocarditis, and the dyspnea is the principal complaint, exertional dyspnea, orthopnea, and paroxysmal night dyspnea. Nocturnal angina due to the slowing the heart rate and the aortic insufficiency, not like the bradycardia. During night, it's normal to heart rate to be slow, and so the diastole to be more longer, and so the aortic insufficiency to increase and maybe have angina during night, a reduction of diastolic blood pressure. In the physical examination, white pulse pressure, but also have here typical peripheral symptoms of the aortic insufficiency. It may be difficult to remember other times, but one or two are very typical, as corrigals and visible carotid pulsation, or the Müller sign, visible pulsation of uvula, very, very rare, and the Dorsier sign, hurt over with small membrane of stethoscope over the femoral artery as digitally compressed as a gun tone, and apex may be displayed inferolaterally diffuse. The left ventricle may be hyperdynamic contraction. Auscultation is very typical and maybe heard third sound, and also the typical is diastolic murmur immediately after second sound, and heard best along the left sternal border for aortic stenosis, on in the right on the aortic nerve, and maybe the patient be sitting position and leaning forward in expiration. And the duration, the murmur in diastole correlates with severity of aortic regurgitation. Housenflint murmur is mid-diastolic murmur at the apex due to anterograd fall across a mitral valve orificium that has been narrowed, and a combination of rising left ventricle pressure and jet of aortic regurgitation directed to anterior mitral valve leaflet. ACG may be giving left ventricle hypertrophy, left axis deviation, maybe have some ST depression. X-ray give enlarging cardiac shadow, maybe the big the biggest dilatation, and maybe see also dilatated ascending aorta with aortic root pathology when have a combination. Transthoracal echocardiography making and confirm the diagnosis to allow us to assess the severity of the regurgitation, giving us opportunity to estimate the left ventricle dimension, the size of the aortic root, and dilatation of the ascending aorta. So the echocardiography giving very, very good information about left atrium enlargement, left ventricle enlargement. The for typical for acute aortic regurgitation is the high frequency diastolic fluttering of the mitral valve, and Doppler echocardiography maybe give us information about the degree of aortic regurgitation with measurement of left ventricle diastolic pressure. So the severity is according aortic aortic jet also velocity and also a volume which can see especially good on cardiac catheterization as performing and the aortography and left ventriculography. And here you can see cardiomegaly, as you see here, a big size. Do you remember the cardiothoracic index as measured perpendiculars from the most prominent right-sided and most prominent left-sided, and when it's more than 50, to say that the patient has cardiomegaly. As you see here, the shadows of the congestion also maybe in one patient with acute aortic regurgitation. Here is the jet. This is a regurgitant jet. As you see, it going to the end of left ventricle and from aortic valve, and this is high degree aortic regurgitation. Cardiac catheterization maybe give information about concomitant coronary artery disease, also aortic root size on orthography and severity of aortic regurgitation. So can confirm accurately the degree of the regurgitation and the status of left ventricle ejection fraction. Some symptoms are in connection with worsens of prognosis, as the symptoms or signs of the chronic heart failure progress, also progress left ventricular ejection fraction decreasement, or also have episode of sudden death. So these patients may be monitored carefully in the size of the left ventricle, in the size of the ascending aorta, not to decrease the moment of progression of symptoms and signs of chronic heart failure. What is the treatment from the medical aspect? First of all, must routinely follow up on everyone to the ear, and these with normal ejection fraction, asymptomatic severe aortic regurgitation, more often on 3 to 6 months, not to was the moment of the correct operation. And in the early symptoms of the heart failure, maybe giving diuretics, maybe give vasodilators, control the hypertension, angina, chest pain with nitrates, beta blockers use with caution, not to giving bradycardia over 70, it's better for the patient with aortic regurgitation. And so must be manage the patient according their symptoms, according their functional class, and their sizes of the left ventricle, and also according the ejection fraction. And if the ejection fraction begin to fall to 50%, if the systolic and diastolic diameter increase more than 55 millimeter, and diastolic diameter over 70 millimeters. Can you imagine what is the big dilatation these patients must be discussed for operation? So the severe or acute aortic regurgitation want prompt surgical interventions and indications for valve replacement. Pure severe chronic aortic regurgitation are symptomatic patients with normal left ventricle function, symptomatic patients with left ventricle dysfunction or dilatation, asymptomatic patients, as you see, with increased end diastolic diameter more than 55 millimeters, ejection fraction under 50%, and also increased diameter of the aortic root over 50 millimeter, and with beginning the symptoms and without surgery, as you see, decrease the survival of the patients, and on the third to five years are only 30% alive, and as you see here, the good results if the patients are with NIHA functional class and have prolongation of the life to 11% first years, and also on the second functional class. But if the functional class become 3 to 4, their life expectancy is very low. So it's very, very important to think for early operation in acute aortic regurgitation. It may be present as cardiogenic shock with the acute pulmonary edema, and the previous here maybe have, of course, normal size left ventricle, but maybe have high pressures because you have no time for compensatory mechanism. Patients are often extremely unstable tachycardic with the picture of the cardiogenic shock, with periphery vasoconstriction, often have pulmonary edema. The pulse pressure is near normal, not as in the chronic aortic regurgitation. Must ask for previous valvular heart disease, hypertension, features of Marfan syndrome, family history, of course, and risk factors for infective endocarditis. If the patient is with prosthesis or have no valve disease. What are the physical signs of the acute aortic regurgitation? Quiet aortic closure sound, and maybe very, very slow in intense sound. Maybe hear ejection systolic murmur over the aortic valve, but the typical is early diastolic murmur. Quiet first sound, which is due to premature closure of the mitral valve, and on the echo is very typical to see flapping on the anterior leaflet of the mitral valve. Both can give you from the acute big regurgitation volume of a premature closure of the mitral valve. So the very helping in this situation is transesophageal echo. people help diagnose in infective endocarditis to looking more better best the valve and differentiation diagnosis of thrombus or endocarditis. Also in the desiccation of the aorta also can help of the supravalvular lesions also. So patients with acute severe aortic regurgitation may for a short time respond to intravenous diuretic and vasodilators, especially sodium nitroprusside, arterial vasodilator, but giving very, very slowly because the patient may be in with cardiogenic shock and must control hypotonia. As you see, intra-aortic balloon contrapulsation is indicated, although here the picture in cardiogenic shock, every aortic regurgitation is contraindication for intra-aortic balloon contrapulsation, but the blockers must avoid it, and surgery is the treatment of choice. Tricuspid stenosis is other valvular disease, very, very rare, usually arrhythmatic, very often maybe with mitral stenosis, and giving the picture of clinical of right-sided heart failure with hepatomegaly, ascites, edema, jaundice, and giving systolic diastolic rumbling murmur along left sternal border and with 12 presystolic component. Chest x-ray giving right atrial and superior vena cava enlargement and also maybe giving transvalvular gradient on the level of tricuspidal valve. And in severe tricuspidal stenosis, the treatment is valvular repair or replacement. Tricuspidal regurgitation is very, very often when you have maybe functional to the dilatation, to the pulmonary hypertension, one have marked right ventricle dilatation, clinical manifestation of severe right ventricle failure with edema, hepatomegaly, and here the systolic murmur is typical, but all right-sided murmurs increase by inspiration. That is the difference with the murmurs from the left-sided. Doppler echocardiography may confirm the diagnosis and estimate the severity. The therapy is therapy of heart failure with diuretics and in the severe cases, maybe tricuspidal anuloplasty or valve replacement. Have you any questions?
No.
No?
Yes, actually, yeah. Regarding the schedule,